What is up? This is the Too Tall Sports Podcast. Thank you for joining me today. My guest is Juan Juan. Yes, believe it or not, Juan Juan. He is the CEO of Fanalyze, which is a sports information and data app that combines everything you need, all the websites you need to search, all the stuff for fantasy players and game bettors, all in one place. So everything you need is in one app. It's really cool. It's a spin-off of all the different fantasy apps that you've ever known. And this is the one-stop shop for all your Google of sports information data, basically. So really cool episode with the CEO of Fanalyze, Juan Juan. As always, you can follow me at Too Tall Sports Podcast. That's on Instagram. On Twitter, it's at Too Tall Sports. Please check out our YouTube channel. You can just type in Too Tall Sports Podcast. You can find us there. Subscribe, hit the bell notification to get notified every time an episode drops, which is usually on Thursday mornings. And drop a comment, share it with a friend. That'd be awesome. Always trying to grow the brand and help us out if you enjoy the show. So we appreciate it. On the audio side, you can listen on Apple Podcasts. Find us there, Too Tall Sports Podcast. Scroll all the way down. If you could, hit the 5-star to give us a 5-star rating so we could boost our exposure. And also, you can follow us on Spotify. We have it on there as well. We're on Pandora. We're on Amazon Music, Google Play, wherever you get your podcasts. We're there, Podchaser, iHeartRadio. Doesn't matter. We're always there. So just type in Too Tall Sports Podcast. We'd really appreciate it. And check us out. So today, my episode is with Juan Juan, the CEO of Fanalyze. I'll see you on the other side. All right, welcome back to the Too Tall Sports Podcast. My next guest is the CEO of Fanalyze. It's a sports data app revolutionizing the way fantasy players, sports bettors, and fans receive real-time information all in one place, all in one app. My guest is originally from the Philippines before settling in the Bay Area many years ago, and he's alumni of San Jose State. He is Juan Juan. What's up, Juan? Glad to have you on the show, man.
Thanks, Brett. Appreciate the opportunity and love to be here. For sure.
Sure, man. Glad to have you on. I think you got a great concept, which we're going to go all the way into in the second half of the interview. I just want to, of course, you know, give your background a little bit first. So glad to have you here and exciting stuff you're doing, man.
Yeah, it is exciting, especially with the sports betting market just exploding. We definitely want to be in the space for sure.
Yeah, no, I think you guys definitely will have a space once we get to that for sure. So let's talk about your background a little bit. And before I got to start, of course, people are going to ask, you know, your name's Juan Juan. So if you could give a little background on that, let us know how that name came to be.
Yeah, I'm actually a junior. So my dad is Juan Juan. But when we moved here, he actually changed it to John because Juan and then John is American for Juan. So sure. But I stayed Juan Juan because the man so nice, they named him twice. Right. So that's me. And you could say some names in the Philippines more, I would say. Jojo, there's, you know, names similar to that. So it was kind of common to repeat it, but that was more nicknames, but mine is the real deal. So
you could have been Triple J if you had the junior in there, right?
Yeah, I could be Triple J.
There you go.
They call me Juan Squared.
Okay. So
I could have been J cubed, yeah.
There you go. Like Triple G, the boxer, you could have been Triple J, man.
Triple G, that's right.
So I mentioned off the top, you're originally from the Philippines, right? Do you remember moving from there to the States when you were younger, or were you too young to remember that?
No, I was 7 years old, but okay. We actually moved to Hawaii first for a couple of years and then landed in San Jose. But I do remember, you know, just being in a new world from a third world country. Still pretty young, but still, you know, it's a different world. But my parents sacrificed their life to give us a better opportunity and really grateful for that. Yeah, I just remember going, you know, flying in the plane in the first time and seeing a different world. So
yeah. What was the transition like for you coming? I mean, like, how did you adjust when you got over here? Like, is, you know, English being probably a second language for you? And how was that for you?
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, from the get-go, English is, in the Philippines, that's probably a common there. So we learned it, you know, early in school, but of course it was my native language. So started learning it elementary. So I got used to it, but you know, it took a while to get familiar.
Yeah.
But you know, but my, you know, the teacher said, tell your parents to not speak. Tagalog was my native language. And so, you know, so we could learn English. I don't know if that backfired on us because I can't speak Tagalog anymore. So, but that's how we started to learn English at early.
Gotcha. Okay. And then I know you're a huge sports fan. So, you know, what were you watching when you were in the Philippines for the most part? And then when you came over here, what was, I'm sure there was like a whole new world for you, like you said, with sports. So what kind of sports and maybe players that you grew up watching did you gravitate toward?
Yeah, no, I mean, early in the Philippines, I don't know if I watched any sports, too much TV, but when we got here, actually boxing was huge for us, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Mike Tyson was pretty big. Sugar Ray Leonard, Hearns. I mean, my uncles, they used to have weekly parties for boxing. So that's how I started with, you know, watching boxing on a continuous basis. And I enjoyed it. I was like a Mike Tyson fan. But for NFL, Dan Marino was my role model. I mean, I watched him battle it out with, you know, the 49ers and Joe Montana. But I don't know, just, Joe, you know, Dan Marino's quarterbacking skills really just got to me. And then for basketball, I'm a Showtime fan. So Magic Johnson was my guy. So when I was playing basketball, I would do baby hooks and no look passes. So
okay,
those are the two that I truly remembered following and being role models. So
well, you picked the right team in the Lakers, that's for sure. I mean, obviously the Warriors are good now, and the Kings had a little run in the early 2000s, but you made the right
that's
choice,
right.
I think.
Thanks, Brett.
Are you still a Lakers fan today?
I try to follow. Yeah. I try to follow as much as I can.
Okay.
I do try to watch their games. Yeah.
Nice. Okay. That's cool. As far as like when you were looking to go to college, you know, when you got to, you know, your later high school years, and I know you went to San Jose State, but what drew you to that school? Did you have any other potential schools you were looking at besides that?
No, I mean, probably I should have applied to more. That was what I got accepted in, and it's pretty close to home. So
okay.
I was more comfortable in that. And I think they had a good program being in Silicon Valley. So they had a network that was definitely beneficial for me. You know, I'm a Spartan. I like the Spartans. So
I think that's cool, man. So you didn't have to go to Stanford or you didn't have to go to Cal and become who you are today. That's awesome.
Yeah. It's not where you start. It's where you end, right?
That's right. And as far as like campus life there, I've never been to San Jose State before. So what was it like on campus there when you were going to school?
Yeah, it was nice. I mean, you know, they had a nice gym where we could play every day, and, you know, student union. They have that church there, which is a classroom, but it was a nice campus. When I was going there, we made it to the tournament, the NCAA tournament, for the first time, but we were probably last seed.
Okay.
We played Kentucky. So it was exciting. I mean, you know, we made the tournament. I'm like, yeah, this is awesome. So there was a lot of hype there, but I enjoy the campus and all the activities they did provide.
Yeah,
so.
Definitely. As far as like what your career focus was, when you were going to school, did you have any idea kind of what you wanted to do leaving college? Like what were you majoring in? Like what were you thinking you were going to do as a career?
Yeah. I mean, you know, living in Silicon Valley, there's a lot of tech startups in that era. Right. But, I had a senior class that did web design, a project, and I really liked that. And I kind of gravitated to that. And we also did a business plan for our business class. So I was like, you know, one day I'm going to, you know, start my own online internet company. So that was my focus, and then try to learn as much as I can, understanding business, online business and launching a company. So
that's pretty cool. So you knew back then you wanted to ultimately do what you're doing now or some version of that, but you didn't go right into that right out of college though. You decided to, speaking of boxing, you decided to work for the Asian Journal. That was what it was called. And you had to cover boxing matches in Philippines and in Vegas. And you got to cover Manny Pacquiao, which, of course, is probably the most famous person from the Philippines. So how did you go from I'm a web designer to I'm going to cover boxing now?
Yeah, no, I mean, that opportunity just came about. One day I was watching with Marquez and Pacquiao. I'm like, I need to sit closer. I was in the bleacher seats. I'm like, this is too far. I need to sit closer. And I saw those photographers. I'm like, I want to get there, right? So I'm like, how do I get there? So I knew someone at Asian Journal, and I asked them, could I take pictures for you? I'll go to the Pacquiao fights and take pictures and then send them over to you. And they said, yeah, you could do that for us. And so kind of signed up for my media pass and so forth, but got that. And I'm like, this is crazy. So I went to the first fight. I think it was a Dave Diaz fight against Pacquiao, and Pacquiao knocked him out. And that, you know, after that, I was started going to every fight until he got bigger. Then it was hard to get that media pass.
Right.
You know, I just wanted to be in that ring, capture some of the moments. I want to share some of.
If you're watching on YouTube, we get to see these passes here.
This is the De La Hoya Pacquiao fight, and then the Cotto fight here. So that's those are two sweet. Big fights, but De La Hoya was huge. I mean, that pretty much put Manny Pacquiao to the next level. Like, he was so, you know, he was underdog, but when he stopped the fight against De La Hoya, everyone went crazy, right? Especially, yeah. You know, Filipinos in the U.S., worldwide, of course, in the Philippines. So that was a great win for us, and glad to have the opportunity to be there live, right? So,
wow. And was that one in Vegas, the De La Hoya fight?
That was in Vegas, yeah. Vegas is always, you know, that's where it's at.
Yeah. What's it like? I've never been to a professional boxing match on that level. What's it like being in the arena there?
It depends. I mean, the crowd is crazy. I mean, one side is, you know, rooting, you know, Pacquiao. One side is rooting De La Hoya.
Right.
It's really, yeah, I've never felt that excitement. I haven't been to any big, you know, bowl games, but I would say that was the most excitement I've felt in a sports event, I would say. You know, I was somewhat biased to Pacquiao, but sure. Definitely, you know, I had best times of my life in sports events for sure.
Yeah, definitely. And you didn't stay in that for too long, though. You decided to get back into tech and you started working for Apple, actually, which is pretty exciting. I wanted to ask you about that. You know, go ahead.
No, before Apple, I worked at several tech startups.
Okay.
So Asian Journal was somewhat on the side, but definitely a benefit for me. After, you know, working for a few startups, I went to Apple as a web designer, I believe 2006, 2007. And, you know, I designed websites for the support section. And I could say Steve Jobs saw my work, you know, because we had new designs for, I would say, a new launch. And they sent my designs to Steve Jobs, and Steve Jobs saw it and saved my email for sure for that evidence. Wow. So, definitely enjoyed the time there at Apple as well.
07, that was like the boom of the iPhone, if I remember That's correctly.
Right. Yeah.
That was crazy.
After that, yeah.
Because I remember, obviously, in the early 2000s, they had the iPod. Like, that was a big deal.
Yeah, iPod came first. Yeah,
right. And then around that 06, 07, like the Apple phone or, you know, iPhone just came out, and that would like revolutionize everything.
Yeah, so, no.
Did you have a part in that at all, or just designing website stuff?
Just designing. Yeah, okay. I helped with, you know, kind of the support side as well. Okay. So understanding, you know, how to use the iPhone and iPod, I would say, but that was about it. Yeah.
What was it like working for Apple? Like, what kind of things did you learn that you took away from there, or how they process things? Like, what was it like for you to take some of that stuff to what you're doing now?
Yeah, I mean, their, you know, attention to detail is very important. In a bigger company, you're more focused on certain things, not compared to like a startup when you wear many hats, right? So there's definitely a routine there, and the collaboration from the other departments also helped. So just learning from my peers was great for me, especially at early age.
Yeah. And then, so you mentioned you work for a few startups. So Fanalyze is your third startup. So what do you think, is this third time's a charm here with startups? You think this will be the one that pops for you?
Yeah. You know, I'm passionate about this. The other ones wasn't really something that will keep me, you know, going. This is something I want to see go through and make it to the finish line. So this is something I wanted to solve for myself. And that's why, you know, I'm here fighting the fight.
Okay. And let's talk about that. What was the, so explain what Fanalyze is. What was the concept and why did you think you could make a, you know, there's a lot, obviously a ton of competition out there, but what was the concept for Fanalyze?
Yeah. So my co-founder and I, you know, we played fantasy football together for probably over 15 years. And we usually won. We're the, you know, top one money winners. And I asked them, what do you do to do your analysis and research? So Chris Longway is my co-founder, but he showed me a spreadsheet with macros and stats and scores and calculations. I'm like, that's insane. So he had that. And I told him, here's what I go for: rankings, projections, sin start and news. And we said, let's try to put that together with software. Let's aggregate that information, put it in one location to save users time. And our goal was really to save users time and get them the valuable data that they need. And that's how Fanalyze came about, starting that, building that software. So
that's really cool. And so you met Chris Longboy's your co-founder. You met him playing fantasy football. Have you known him for a long time?
I actually knew him in junior high.
Oh, right.
We ran in our 4x1 relay, but we never lost until the last meet. But we left with the record for our 4x1 relay team. So, and I played high school varsity football with him as well.
Oh, cool.
So I've known him since we were kids. Pretty much, yeah.
That's cool. You guys have the same passion for this stuff. So which are like, what, you know, what does he specialize in and what do you specialize in?
Yeah, so he's the engineer. So he does all the data, backend APIs, the development part. And I'm more the product design guy. So I do more the visual stuff and then the business stuff as well. So it's a good balance for both of us.
Gotcha. Okay. Yep. And then you mentioned a little, you kind of touched on it, but you said you're solving a problem, right? So what do you think is the biggest problem for gamblers or fantasy players or just people, fans trying to get data? Is it just the excess of websites that you need and you guys are just trying to combine it all into one spot? So what problem are you solving?
No, you answered it. When you look for data and research, you have to go several sites and applications to get that content. And we're just trying to put that together to get the best, I would say, consolidated data. And that's what we're trying to do. Instead of, you know, going to 10 websites, you just go to one and go to Fanalyze, right?
So. Right. Okay. Gotcha. And you've also talked about the, like having graphs on there and almost like a stock chart for, you know, performances lately or trends or stuff like that. So how have you tried to make the interface, you know, user-friendly to make it easy on the users?
Yeah, I mean, the graphs was something we wanted to add because people look at trends, right, on a weekly basis. And sometimes you got to go with a hot hand. What we did was we did user testing. We kind of, before we launched, we said, okay, how does our, you know, product look? Give us feedback. And they actually liked the graphs because they could understand the data quicker than looking at each data point.
Right.
So they understand, okay, this player is hot. Let's stick with them. This player is not. Let's drop them, right? So the trend and, you know, the graphs views the trends quickly. And that's what we're trying to do is just trying to make it fast for you to understand the data and what's going on with each player or team, right?
Right. And so, I mean, I've done a little bit of daily fantasy and I've done regular fantasy forever. And I know exactly what you're talking about, combining all these websites. So what I guess for the people that don't understand, like, you know, looking at Twitter feeds for the beat writers who cover the teams,
you got...
you know, other websites that talk about, you know, is a player's in or out that day, or, and then you got the stats websites. It's just a lot of stuff to sift through. And you guys are going to put that all in one spot, which I think is really cool.
All in one spot, Brett.
Yeah.
That's
cool. I want to talk about the gambling aspect of this. So having real time in-game data would be a game changer for everybody because nobody really has that I'm aware of. So how are you guys going to be able to spit out data like that in game, you know, with the software and have it, you know, not, you know, crash or something like that, or just have, be able to have people put in their in-game bets right away when this data is coming in like that?
Yeah, no, we've been looking into that. You know, I don't think we're going to crash. We're on AWS, Amazon's AWS. Sure. So they'll definitely help us going, but in-app analysis, you know, it's now in the present and the future. So we're focused on getting that data to you through search, right? So, you know, player outcomes, quarter outcomes, halftime outcomes. So we could, you know, provide that calculation, whether this this kicker is going to make this 50-yard kick field goal, right? We say he only made one out of five, right? It's what, 20%? That's, I don't think he's going to make this one, right? So, you know, different, I would say, analysis to help you with those in-app analysis or in-app bets, right? So we're providing that through search, say, is this kicker going to make this 50-yard field goal, or, you know, rename the kicker? But that's how we're doing it, through pretty much NLP and machine learning and artificial intelligence.
So would somebody have to be monitoring, you know, how like some of the sports apps, like they digitally give you the game cast per se, where they're, you know, they're moving the ball wherever the team is.
That's correct.
It would have to be really quick, unless you have a timeout or something like that, to evaluate.
I know, person, yeah.
Right. That's the hard part.
That is the hard part. Yeah. And then, you know, we're building that engine to make that calculation quickly, because if you're maybe 5 seconds late, it's too late. Right.
Right. So you can't get the bet in.
Yeah, no, that's why we're building technology around that to solve that problem.
I think when you guys do that, yes, that is a absolute game changer, man. So I hope you guys can deliver on that, because that's going to be really cool.
Yeah. We deliver. That's our goal.
No, I have no doubt in my mind. No, I like it, man. I love the concept, because no one's been able to really do this. You know, like everybody, like I was saying, everyone has their different websites and that's what they specialize in. Yeah. But you guys are going to be the one-stop shop for all this stuff.
Yep. In-app analysis. We're coming.
Exactly. What have some of your biggest challenges so far? You know, what have you ran into? Is there anybody that's doing something similar, or is it the customer experience? What have you seen as the toughest challenge so far?
Yeah. I mean, you know, of course the pandemic was a challenge with no live sports, but we were able to get through that. Always, you know, customer acquisition is always, a tough challenge, right? So you want to get users on your platform and then convert them to paying customers. That's always a challenge. And then fundraising. Any startup that's fundraising, that's a big challenge for you. But, you know, our goal is to show some users, show some revenue, and then eventually land a good amount of funding, right? So that's the plan. But yeah, those are a few challenges that we have currently.
Okay, gotcha. And then as far as, you know, the customer acquisition stuff, you know, is it going to be a subscription model, you know, for, let's just say someone who just wants fantasy data or just wants gambling data, or is it going to be probably the same for everybody who uses the app?
Yeah, no, you know, there is an overlap of fantasy sports players and sports bettors. I would say maybe around 70%, but we kind of separate that out, fantasy data for players and then team data for sports bettors. So we do separate that out, and it'll be a premium subscription model.
Okay. And then you get everything if you have the premium subscription?
Yeah, we're definitely allowing the premium. So you get all the sports that we have on our platform for a discounted price.
Okay. Gotcha. And then as far as like getting, you know, certain people's Twitter feeds, like how do you, like it would just be, I know you the kind of your cool tagline is you want to be the Google of sports betting data, basically, right? So is it going to be, you can search anybody's Twitter feed in there, you can search all that, like how are you going to incorporate the social media aspect to it?
Yeah, I mean, you know, right now you can search players and teams, and you can search two or three players for that side-by-side analysis. Eventually, you know, you could search scores, you could search, you know, like you said, a player and their Twitter feeds. So whatever we have in our database and you search for that, we'll get that to you right away using natural language processing, which I work with, you know, two natural language processing startups, two of them. So understand the technology and what we need to build.
Yeah, no, it sounds really cool.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you about what it's like when you do these presentations and the business pitch competitions and stuff like that. Like what are those rooms like, and, you know, how's it been for you so far?
Yeah, no, I mean, doing pitch competitions for the last 6 months, and we probably won about six of them. So
that's impressive, man.
Yeah. So we won a pitch day at the Coliseum Sports Tech demo day. We won the Sports Betting USA Conference pitch competition, which was big for us. We won, you know, a TV show pitch competition, and we won like 5,000 from Arizona State Venture Devils demo day. So, you know, a way for us to share what we're building and also possibly win some money, right? So and it takes practice. I mean, you know, I make sure I know the amount of time that I need to pitch, whether it's 2 minutes, 3 minutes, or 5 minutes. It varies. So you have to practice that time and you continue to do it to make sure you're comfortable and make sure you're ready. And of course, you got to sell your vision, your story, right? So, everyone has a pitch, but the story comes out. We end up winning. So definitely a good sign for us.
Yeah, that's awesome. And it's really cool that you guys have won all those competitions. And you recently were in the top 10 of the Chinese Sports Tech Conference?
Yeah, it was Aqua Bloom Sports Technology Group and GSIC powered by Microsoft. So they're more Europe-based, China-based market. So we actually, we won top 10 for that and landed a pilot opportunity for the Winter Olympics that we pitched. So we focused on the Winter Olympics to add into our technology, and they ate it up. Yeah, we made top 10, and we'll be working with them to launch that in China.
That's really cool.
Winter Olympics, yeah.
Yeah, and that's another thing I wanted to ask you about is, obviously you can get the domestic sports, but what about international sports too? How's that going to work when it's, overseas, people using the app from all over the world?
Yeah, no, we're actually working on cricket data for the IPL league. So
interesting.
We'll work with the team there because we don't understand that market too well.
Sure.
So we'll have a team there to kind of launch that. And then, of course, soccer or football data, as you say, is big worldwide. So it's another sport we want into our platform. But with limited resources, we just want to try to stay focused and get going here in the U.S. first.
Right. You want to make sure you get at least lock that down before you branch out too far. That's pretty interesting about the Olympic data, though, because obviously there can be gambling on that, too. The data on those people, it's maybe a little harder to find unless they were in the Olympics before 4 years ago or something like that. But what do you think you guys are going to do for the Winter Olympics?
Yeah, I mean, just similar, search athletes, search countries, search medals, trying to, get the latest updates and news and events. We're also trying to integrate as much social media as possible, whether it's TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, to get the user to kind of feel that they're actually at the event, looking at videos and pictures and so forth. So we're trying to integrate all of the social media to get the user feeling that they're at the Olympics.
And I want to go back to kind of the pitch meetings and stuff like that, because I imagine it being kind of like Shark Tank, where you're on with some investors and some big name people that want to invest. So what's it like? What kind of questions do you get from them? What are they looking for, right? Obviously, it's a bottom line business. What's your revenue? All that stuff. But, is it just, are some of them okay with selling the idea and the future they believe in, or they want to see, I want to see what kind of money you're bringing in already?
Both, right? So they, okay, to de-risk, they want to see, revenue in the bank, right? And then you're growing. But some people, look at moonshots. Okay, if he actually builds that Google for sports data, that's pretty big, right? So you sell the vision, but there's probably a lot more people that want the revenue so they could de-risk their investment. We're going for a grand slam. And we're selling that vision. And that's been our plan from the get-go.
So. Right. Are you going to want at some point for people to do fantasy on your app, or just for information? It's more of a search engine for sports information.
We talked about that possibly internationally. We didn't want to compete with the Yahoos, the CBS, but if we have, we have millions, we could turn that on. So that's been a thought, but we might test that out internationally first.
Okay.
And then come back in the US and, once you get that user base, then it's easy to turn that on. So that's our goal first, is really get millions on our platform and then figure that out for sure.
Right. Yeah. No, you gotta build it first. No, totally understand.
Build it first. Yeah.
Yeah. I guess what are the kind of the goals moving forward for Fanalyze? I know you got to obviously keep building out the platform, but I guess, the next few years, what are you guys really looking to do with Fanalyze?
Yeah. Next few years, we'll hopefully have the top 10 sports globally. We currently have three now. Cricket should launch. We'll have four this year. I don't know if you call Olympics a sport, but different sports there. But 10, we'd love to have, maybe a million active users per week, per month. So that's always a goal. And of course, a profitable business in 3 years. And not just, you could search players and teams, but you could search all sports data in our platform. So
let's talk about some of the people on your staff. So you've had some big names come in that are notable in the sports world. So who are some of the people that, you know, people, you know, fans may know, or just people in the business world might know about?
Yeah, David Meltzer came in as an advisor and now an investor. So David Meltzer is a co-founder of Sound One Marketing. He was a previous CEO at Steinberg Athletes Entertainment. So he's pretty big, and he coined the phrase, "Show me the money" on the Jerry Maguire. So he's been a great advisor for us, investor, team member. Sam Lee, who was a past VP of legal at the NBA. So he's definitely been helping us with, you know, agreements, contracts, and partnerships. And we also have Eric Glover, who built Ask.com. I don't know if you know Ask Jeeves.
Yeah.
So he's been helping us with building the right infrastructure for our sports search engine. So
you got some heavy hitters on that roster, yeah, man.
We do. I mean, working for several startups, it's really that team that will get you to point A to point B. And that's what we're trying to build as an A team. I mean, that's my goal as a CEO, and trying to get the best people in our team.
If you can get the NBA on board, or obviously NFL is the big one, but if you can get, I mean, if your guy Sam can get the NBA, that'd be a pretty huge one.
I'm definitely working on him on that when we're ready, for sure.
Okay, nice, man. Now you'll get there. I want to give you a chance to, of course, plug all your stuff and let us know. So it's a crowdfunding opportunity here with Republic. So let everybody know where they can invest and check out Fanalyze.
Yeah, we just launched our equity crowdfunding at republic.co/Fanalyze. I mean, you can invest as low as $100 and up, right? So anyone can invest. They don't have to be accredited. And would love you to support our vision and our goals. Go to Republic, and then you can take a look at our website as well, fanalyze.com, and also social medias /fanalyze for Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. So
yeah, definitely. No, I think it's a great idea, and I think you guys are going to kill it. And is the app usable right now, or is it still in the beta stage?
Nah, you could use it. We just launched NBA. So we have NFL, MLB, and NBA now. So we're trying to go fast, but we love feedback. You know, we're still pretty early stage. So
sure.
My background in product design, I like to talk to users, make sure we build the right things for them, and make sure the product is working the way they want it, right? So
you've always said you're a product guy, right? Because that was your background. Yeah, so you like to focus on that. Yeah. No, that's awesome. Well, no, I appreciate you being on. I'm glad to support Fanalyze, and I wish you the best of luck. So thank you very much. And I hope everything goes well for you guys.
Yeah, no, thank you, Brett. Appreciate the opportunity. And then definitely we'll talk soon.
Okay, sounds great. My thanks to Juan. What a great episode with him. Check out Fanalyze all over the internet. Go check out their app, and you can invest. I'm thinking about investing myself. I think it's a great concept, and I think it's definitely a revolutionary concept that they have. So it's going to change the game of in-game sports betting, real-time data. So really cool product that they have. And my thanks to Juan for a great interview today. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that one. You can always follow me at Too Tall Sports Podcast. That's on Instagram. You can follow my Twitter feed at Too Tall Sports. Please find us on YouTube to watch the interviews, and subscribe, hit the bell notification so you get notified every time we drop an episode, which is on Thursday mornings. And you can also follow us on Apple Podcasts. Please scroll all the way down past the episodes, hit the 5-star. That would really help us out a lot. And if you want to listen on Spotify, we're also there. We're on Pandora. We're on Amazon Music, Google Play. You guys know what it is. It's everywhere. So thanks for all your support and listening, and reach out anytime with any comments and feedback. I love to hear from you guys. So thanks again for listening, and I'll see you next week on the Too Tall Sports Podcast for another great episode. Have a good one.